let's go ahead and get started with just a brief silence together and just to arrive in the space. Just feeling your seat in the chair or your feet on the ground. Taking some deep breaths. Dropping into present time. And there may be a movement that you need to make to adjust. Or you might feel some energy moving through you, and that's okay. I don't plan this. But when we open ourselves up to what is here, we might feel some sensations besides just nothing. We might experience some movement. We may even experience sound. Okay. So, I'm gonna get started. And for those of you who have worked with me in some capacity, you know, I do channel, and sometimes that comes out with breath and movement, sometimes shaking, and it's not a part of what I will talk about today, but it just happened, you know. And what I the calling of having a non-dual talk is to share with you what I received from my teacher and my master in India, and also just through through understanding. And there's a very specific piece of that that I am called to transmit to you. The other things, like what's happening in my body, or what you know, what might be happening phenomenologically for me or for you, is also important. That's also what's happening in duality, in consciousness. But it's not the point that I'm wanting to convey today. Because what I am interested in sharing with you and to discuss with you is beyond a state. It's beyond striving for something separate from what is your actual experience. So if I were to say, you have to experience this in your body at this moment, or these are the steps to attainment, then I would be telling you partial truth, and those things are all fine. Those things are all fine. Tools that we use, whether it's yoga or meditation or psychology, whatever we use to develop the human, that's fine. But what I'm interested in is what happens when those things fail. What happens when those things don't bear fruit, or they're temporary? And then what happens is, often we, and this used to be me, would blame myself. I would feel like I was doing something wrong, or that there was something I wasn't getting. And then there was frustration, and that is the definition of suffering. The definition of suffering, as I say it, is wanting to be something other than it is. So the seeking mind, separate from what is, the separate mind is suffering. Seeking is suffering. Seeking for something other than what is here and now, not in the future and not in the past. Here and now. And when there is the complete apprehension of that, and when there is the complete, no questions, and it's okay to get it 100% intellectually. That's really great. That's good. In my understanding, what I am one person with one awakening. There are an infinite number of facets of awakening, but the one that I get here for you is that it is okay to have 100% intellectual understanding of this, and that's a tool. That's the sword, the clarity. And when that's dropped into, when it drops into the heart, you could say, or when it's realized 100% intuitively, it's apprehended as a whole, the whole mind groks it, and there's no questioning whatsoever. It's the direct experiencing of it, and there's no flip-flop back into the questioning of that. Then there's, you would say, complete release of the identification with the egoic mind. Complete release with the identification. There's an understanding, there's a seeing, and there's you would say, an experiencing. There's a seeing that there is no separate, there is no separation, that there is no separate individual. I call it, there is no separate doer, there is no separate volition, and there is, it's like, how did I word it? It was almost like a computer, like there is no separate operating mechanism. There's a seeing that there is no one there. There is no separate doer there. When one looks, I mean, you could look right now. What is that? Is that a thought? I am doing something? Who? Who is that? Who? Where is that? Can you find it? No. Where is it? Who? Look. There's no one there. Who? Who? So it is arising. Life is being lived. It is arising. It is arising. It is arising out of the plenum, out of oneness. Life is happening. Life is happening through this body-mind organism. Like every single thing, from the trees to the air, whatever is arising. And so when I mentioned that, I think I'm gonna open this. Do you mind, Keith, would you flip this up for me? When I call the name of this talk Unshakeable Peace, which is just a tagline to try to put a name to something that doesn't really have a name, because once something is named, it is false. Once something is named, it's false. It's only an aspect of it. It's only an aspect of it, whatever it is. So for me to even put words to this is already, we're finished. It's just pointers. These are pointers. So unshakable peace. So most obvious example that I can give is the eye. The eye of a hurricane. We have hurricanes going on right now on the planet. We have the eye of the hurricane. The eye, the eternal subject. There is an eternal subject. I am. In the eye, anything can be occurring around that eye. Anything. Loss, death, suffering, pleasure, anything can be occurring. Barbecue, something smells really good. So in the eternal subject, the I, anything can arise and pass away. I am resting in that eternal I. I am the I. It's not the I separate from what is. So anything can be occurring. Stress, even anxiety. And there's a place of rest. No matter what. That's where you get to stay. And it's like the tip of a pin. That's all you get. There's nowhere to go. Because the minute that you stray from the I am, the mind, you're gone. The thoughts can come and go. The thoughts can come and go. It's a radio show. But there's no belief in them. This is really important. It's empty. There's no belief in the story anymore. What do I mean by belief? There's no there. So let's talk politics. That's a good one. People like to talk about politics. What's going on over there? What's that? What's the other thing? What's that? Do we really know? What is happening? Is that happening right here in my direct experience? And even if it happened 5 minutes ago, are you sure that that happened? Absolutely not. I can feel somebody is having some discomfort right now in the room. I don't know who it is. Somebody is having some discomfort in the room. All that we know is what is here, and even that moment is gone. So, going back to politics or business, we can try to play the game. We can play the game. Why not? There's no problem with it. We have to play the game. We're marionettes. It's going to happen. That's consciousness is arising through this body-mind organism as it's conditioned, as it's genetically conditioned and environmentally conditioned from moment to moment, from moment to moment. And the conditioning is infinite. It's not separate from everything that is happening all at once. How could it be just the conditioning of your parents or Oakland or whatever? No. Where does the thread end? It doesn't. So, how could there be a separate will? How could there be a separate volition? So we play the game, whether it's business or family or politics, to the extent that we have the receptors for it, the fact that it's arising in this body-mind. Some of us have zero interest in one of those facets. Some of us have a lot of interest in it. There's a lot of energy. Sometimes there's activism even. You know, it's like, oh, that's happening. But there's a lot of suffering in those things too, right? Activism in politics and business and family and whatever, because of what should be happening. So when there's an understanding, when there's an apprehension that it is not separate from all that is, there's a playing of the game, there's a living of the life with, just like if you go to a movie at the Grand and you experience the fear or the passion or whatever it is, with an understanding that it comes and goes, and there's no separate control over any of it. There's no possible way that we could have, there's no possible way. We try to usurp the mind of the whole. We try to usurp the consciousness as a whole. We try to be God, and we try to think that we could do something. We can try, but it's a tiny thread. And if it is our programming, if it is our destiny, as it were, to play on that thread, we will. But we don't have to suffer. We don't have to feel upset if it doesn't work. Or that we're doing it wrong. We may keep trying. That's fine. But we don't need to feel shame or guilt that something isn't going the way that we think it should. Because it's an infinite number of causes and effects. Infinite. You see what hubris we have? How we think we're so powerful. That's the ego. And there's no problem with the identified ego when there is this understanding, because it's going to do whatever it's going to do. It's going to bounce around. It's an, I call somebody's name, and that's where they identify. That body, mind of consciousness is identified with that name. There's no problem with that. But there's no belief that that egoic point of identification is responsible. The feeling of separate responsibility is suffering. It could never be anything different. So the last thing I'll say, because I've already talked far more than I thought, is when I said in the quote on the Satsang announcement that unshakable peace, and that being in the now is the ultimate in self-care. I just want to put a nod to that since I put the quote in there. What does that mean? It's going to mean something different depending on the person that's asking the question. So I'm going to pause. And see if anybody wants to ask some questions or have a dialogue.